Jesus said, the first commandment your side. Who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
My Lord is my say to you in the name of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep, and Miles
miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. The poem describes something very true about the Lenten journey. The grace of stopping, or at least slowing down enough to appreciate the beauty of a winter landscape. In the case of yesterday afternoon, a beautiful sunny day, for a particularly nourishing piece of literature or music, providing a stop and smell the roses moment in a sanctuary devoid of flowers most of the time. Yet there's an urgency in this poem that also says something true about the Lenten journey. There is a need to keep going, to honor the promises we made to ourselves, to our loved ones, to our communities, to those with whom we are in relationship, most importantly to God. We have miles to go. Abram awaits the fulfillment of God's promise in a very long journey, knowing that in our Bible, this takes place in the first book of the Bible, and was just visually a very thick, long story. It's the beginning of a covenantal relationship, many miles, many millennia of relationship, of covenant. And Abram waits on the Lord. And God, in a dream, meets with Abram, and on a dark and dreamy night, cuts a covenant with him, passing between the divided offerings in the form of fire, just as people in the ancient world would do the same, cutting the offerings in half. And the two covenantal parties walk between those things together, symbolizing a new path forward, and in the case of a break in that covenant, a sign by the torn carcasses on either side of the consequences of breaking it. And so God and Abram enter into the covenant together. It tells us that God is in this for the long haul. The promise is enduring. The covenant is a living document, the inheritance of eternal life for us. And when God reveals to Abram what will be the kingdom, it's beyond the limits of his sight. It's the most expansive vision of what the kingdom of God, what is promised to the people of God in the Bible. From the Nile to the Euphrates, from Egypt to Iraq, those horizons stretch beyond the limit of Abram's sight from any earthly vantage point. And Jesus foreshadows that he has much more work to accomplish in our world, continuing to do his ministry before entering into Jerusalem. Before we celebrate on Palm Sunday, Jesus riding into Jerusalem for his triumphant return, where the people say, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." He has promises to keep and miles to go before he sleeps. And so do we. New ministries are afoot here at Trinity. Several new vestry members have joined the ministry of leading our church for the years to come. And we welcome our new deacon, Diane Peterson, who can certainly say a thing or two about feeding and healing the wounds in our area as our deanery mission. So excited for our community about the journey ahead, the miles we have to walk together. Our youth this weekend to come will embark on a pilgrimage of a different sort, a 30-hour fam, where lunch in school on next Friday will be their last meal before Eucharist on Saturday night, as we enter into a hunger simulation to raise money to feed others in our world. It's going to be a long journey, as anyone with cranky middle school who's in the house can attest, or any crankiest pussy or characters, if anyone knows what they're like to deal with. And yet, as we walk those after the dark mystery as the light of Christ comes back into our world with the hope of the resurrection, we have preparation to do there in our confirmands, making sure we're ready, that they're ready to reaffirm the promises made on their behalf, that their baptismal covenant that we've set with them on their behalf. They'll be claiming that with their own sense of agency and authority. And in our own lives, we may be honoring promises we've made to ourselves and to our families and to our communities and to our God with varying degrees of success. Eating varying degrees of chocolate, perhaps. However that is going for us, we can know that the grace of God is expansive and limitless. Christ, even on his way to the cross, wants to seek out and heal the brokenness in our world, bringing forth life in amazing and unexpected ways. How could Christ be doing that in us now, on our Lenten journey? Somewhere in these scriptures and in this poem, I felt greatly comforted by the invitation of Frost to step down off of my high horse in a way. Even if I'm on an urgent journey somewhere important or something relevant to what I'm up to in the busyness of ministry this time of Lent, to appreciate something true and beautiful like the beauty of a falling snowflake or a bluebird day of skiing or catching up with a friend I've been meaning to call but just haven't quite gotten around to, I'm hoping to take some of those moments of reflection. Because it's those opportunities to slow down and consider the world around us that the contemplatives of the Society of St. John the Evangelist are all about inviting us into as we reflect on growing a rule of life, building a roadmap so that we can walk the miles ahead in our spiritual journey. And so, whether you step down off your high horse or you've fallen off the wagon, God's grace, God's love, God's commitment to us is truly worth considering. The world may not quite understand as well as it once might have why we as a community, as Christians, pull off the road at Pequot Center to stop and consider what God is up to in our lives here in this place. Coming to church isn't necessarily something you have to do anymore, and yet here we are, in the busyness of our lives, taking a moment to consider where God is, where God is leading us. And so we know that it's pauses like this, whether here, kneeling at the altar rail with a little bread for the journey, that we can go back out into the world, honoring the commitments we've made to God and to each other. And though even though these pews are lovely, dark, and deep, we have promises to keep out in the world, and miles to go before we sleep, and miles to go.
Especially the Andrews family, David, Swan, Helen, Wendy Safley, Kate Dolan, Susan, David Hovey, Catherine, Barbie, Phyllis Kashaw, Margot Prairie, David, Anson, and Susan, Betty Bradshaw, Jackie, Dan, Willie, Ronnie, Patricia, Marcia Gowan, Matt Jotsey, and those we name silently or loud. That we may find shelter and protection under God's wings. Let's pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Come to our aid, Lord God, and grant by your grace that we may walk in the footsteps of your Son, and so come with him to the glory you have promised. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Before we go into the piece, I'd like to ask any vestry members who are here to please come forward for special commissioning prayer to stand along in front of the church here. And I'd also like to ask the Reverend Diane Peterson if she would come forward.
Thank you.
commissioner in the diocese.
One of the things I think you need to know in the church, we have vocational deacons and we have transitional deacons. Matt, my buddy over there, was a transitional deacon, which means he was going on to ordination to the priesthood. My calling, my discernment, is to be a vocational deacon, which means my ministry here within the community is servant's ministry. And that is truly where my privilege lies. So, I'm glad to be here at Trinity. Also, I am the deanery commissioner. And what that is that 15 parishes, including Trinity Southport, make up the Greater Bridgeport Deanery. And that's Southport, Fairfield, Humble, Easton, Monroe, Milford, Stratford, two others in between. And part of that relationship is also the ministry of feeding the hungry, of which Trinity is very supportive. So, having said that, I try to keep us all active. We do two food pantries and three community suppers and three different churches. So I am now here, and for as long as you'll keep me, you're stuck with me. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
ordinance has some changes in our liturgy, beginning with the Ten Commandments, just as a reminder of a rule of life, which is also the subject of our forum hour at 9 a.m. on Sundays here at Lindeman. So be sure to join us if you're interested in the library. We're also enjoying adult coloring with Gail Fick, and put together a book of icons that you can learn how to meditatively color. So that's a lot of fun, and I think there's some in the narthex if you'd like to pick one up. This is what they look like, beautiful quilts. One thing in worship that I want to invite you into is singing the refrain of the song. I notice most of us are maybe your fellow honored by the great singers that you can't sing, but we really can join in. You're invited to sing the refrain of the song each Sunday. I didn't mean to say that for a while. Also, our Lenten theme is serve the Lord with gladness, so this is something to keep in mind as you go through the season. You'll notice that there's an Easter flower insert in your bulletin if you'd like to remember a loved one at Easter. You can fill that out in the yellow leaves. And as I speak of flowers, please note on the altar the bells of Ireland. It's the beautiful green greens on the altar. They are a memory of Dennis Lawson, who was an Irishman, who captured Dennis Lawson funeral services here yesterday. And we remember him with great fondness and love. The Andrews family is in our prayers. This is a tragedy in our community of Fairfield, domestic violence and family secrets. Asking your prayers as we think of all those who suffer from domestic violence and our neighbors unknowing it to us, and to try to be there for our neighbors. We'll have a special coffee hour today right after the service. Cake for Diane, our new desert. So come on and celebrate with all the fellow parishioners. New beginnings. Matt has got a great thing going with the youth on this 30-hour panel, and you can support it by going to our website and encouraging our youth. So please check that out. I will be away this week at a conference in Denver for the church. Also, lastly, we have a new class starting tonight at 7 p.m. called Episcopal 101, and you
had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and the Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
"Our Father,
thank you.
Matthew